The Aaronic high priest, having sacrificed, representing the death of himself and his associates, and having represented this change to a new nature by passing beyond the veil into the Most Holy, came out again and blessed all the people, representing the blessings that are to come to mankind through the new priest after the order of Melchizedek, as soon as the sacrificing shall be finished and accepted. As the eye of faith looks backward over the centuries of this gospel age and perceives the sacrifice made by our great high priest and his entrance into glory, and as we perceive further the little thread of faithful, consecrated followers of the Lamb all the way through the centuries, and as we note in our day multiplying evidences that this little flock of called, chosen, faithful ones will soon have finished their sacrificing, and as we realize that soon they will experience their change from sacrificing priests, antitypical of the Aaronic, and in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, be changed to priests of the Melchizedek order, our hearts are glad for two reasons. First, we trust that some of us will thus shortly hear the Master's welcome voice saying, "Well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joys of thy Lord. Sit down with me in my throne to bless all the families of the earth." Number two, we realize that the glorification of the church marks the time for the beginning of divine blessing to return to natural Israel, from whom in turn it shall flow to all the families of the earth. Who that loves God and his fellow men would not rejoice on learning of this gracious arrangement of the divine plan? Who that loves righteousness and hates iniquity would not be glad to welcome the new dispensation when Satan shall be bound and all the various deceptions by which he has enthralled the world shall be dissolved? Who would not be glad to know that the time is near at hand when the knowledge of the glory of God shall fill the whole earth so completely that none shall need to say to his neighbor, "Know thou the Lord," for all shall know him from the least to the greatest? Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 34. Who would not be rejoiced that soon the confused babel of various changing creeds will be silenced, and that as the prophet has declared, the Lord shall turn unto the people, the masses, a pure message, and they shall all call upon the name of the Lord to serve him with one consent? Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 9. Ah, truly, as the Lord's people now love to sing, "O happy day that fixed my choice on thee, my Savior and my God," so the poor world will soon have the opportunity of singing much after the same strain when the blind eyes shall be opened and the deaf ears unstopped, and all shall be brought to an appreciation of the Lord and of his merciful plan. Why not now, does someone ask? Because, as the Lord declares, "As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my plans than your plans." As we come to understand and appreciate the divine plan, we see that it is by far better than any earthly human plan. And thank God, it is not in the power of either the friends or the enemies of the Lord to change his purposes one iota. He declares, "The word that has gone out of my mouth shall not return unto me void, but shall accomplish that which I please and shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it." The message sent during the Jewish age was merely to take out a typical people, Israel, after the flesh. The message sent during this gospel age has been merely to gather the elect, that they might participate in the sacrificing as antitypical priests like unto Aaron, and that thus they might be prepared to be with their Lord, antitypical priests like unto Melchizedek, for the work of the future, the blessing of the world. The message of the future, as we have seen, will be good tidings of great joy, which shall be unto all people, restitution to human perfection, to all that was lost in Adam. But we remind you that while God has thus provided a great salvation and forgiveness of sins that are past for all mankind, his arrangement is for the punishment of every sin that is willful in proportion to its willfulness. We have heretofore seen that this signifies that some of the human family, having degraded themselves seriously with a measure of willfulness, will have correspondingly the more steps to retrace in order to attain all that was lost and redeemed. It means a just recompense of reward to every soul that doeth evil. It means an opportunity for a proportionate blessing, however, to each one who may have done the least kindness to any member of the elect priesthood, even so much as the giving of a cup of cold water in the name of a disciple. We remind you further that in the divine word there is the assurance that those who continue willfully obdurate and rebellious will ultimately die the second death, from which there will be no hope of recovery. In other words, God is providing in Christ one full redemption from the curse that came upon Adam and his posterity. And this redemption, secured by the precious blood of Christ, must be made available to every member of the race eventually, made available by each being brought to a knowledge of the truth. Then the responsibility will rest upon himself, and his eternal destiny will be such as his course shall merit, either life eternal or death eternal. For ultimately the Lord will have a clean universe, as it is written, "Every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, heard I saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb for ever and ever." Revelation chapter 5, verse 13. In conclusion, dear friends, let us learn to abhor that which is evil and cleave to that which is good as being the very soundest policy for the life that now is and for that which is to come. And those of us who have accepted the divine invitation for joint heirship with the Lord as royal priests, let us appreciate the grand privilege which is ours, and laying aside every weight, let us run with patience the race set before us. Let us be joyful partakers in the sufferings, trials, and oppositions which go to make up the sacrificing of this present time, and while partaking by faith of the glory to follow, let us wait in patience, hope, and trust for a share in the first resurrection, when we shall see our Redeemer's face and share his glory. 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 to 3. A closing poem. Kings for the promised throne, crowns we shall wear. Christ reigns, but not alone, we soon shall share. O ye despised ones, come. Pilgrims no more we'll roam. Sweetly we'll rest at home. Jesus is there.